Hey folks, this is BestInSlot, and tonight I'm hopefully going to give you some cool ideas for alternate genera for your Jurassic World Evolution 2 dinosaurs. This is just a bit of fun and a way to expand, inverted commas, your species roster without actually having to do so. Sometimes we'll use dinosaurs with changed body morphs as an easy way to differentiate. Hell, in a couple of cases you might find that my suggestions fit the dinosaur better than what's in game at the moment. We're also going to specifically name our dinosaurs to sell this illusion a little bit better. This will all make more sense when you've seen it in action. So, here we go, 8 new genera, unlocked right now, absolutely unmodded. First up, we have Giraffa Titan from our Brachiosaurus. Now, this is an obvious choice to kick things off because the original Jurassic Park Brachiosaurus was actually based on Giraffa Titan, though at the time, Giraffa Titan was actually just regarded as an African species of Brachiosaur. Giraffa Titan isn't from North America, but instead from Tendaguru Formation in Tanzania, Africa. This formation was much more tropical than the North American equivalent, and that's perfect for us because it means we can use the slightly differently shaped Brachiosaurus 2001 from Jurassic Park 3 with its sharp pointed brow, dewlap, and tropical colours, making it a really good fit for this. Otherwise, the Amazon rainforest skin colour with the Papyrana and Calcarana skins are also a great fit. Don't worry, we will have some slightly more obscure choices. Next up, we're going to make our Giganotosaurus into a Mapusaurus. Now, Mapusaurus is a Carcharodontosaurid from late Cretaceous Argentina. It's a little bit smaller than Giganotosaurus, but other than that, for our purposes, there really aren't any major differences between the two that we know of. We're going to stick with the original Frontier Giga because the Dominion version is slightly larger. The Huincul Formation, where Mapusaurus was found, was a typically arid environment with occasional waterfall. We're going to utilise the Death Valley and Killeen Mountain skin colours, along with the Rana and Calcarana patterns to represent this. As a bonus little idea, there is evidence of Mapusaurus acting as a pack hunter, or a mob hunter at the very least, so feel free to throw quite a few of these together in one exhibit. We're going to take to our pterosaurs next. We're going to go from Jehalopterus to Anorognathus. Now, Anorognathus and Jehalopterus are both members of the Anorognathidae family, a group of small, short-tailed pterosaurs and, fortunately for our purposes, ones that all have very similar morphologies. Jehalopterus was a really cool choice by Frontier, but Anorognathus is probably the better known of the two after appearing in quite a lot of pop culture, and especially, look, I don't want to talk about its appearance in Primeval, but it happened, that's the reality we live in. As for skin colours, Dodeline, a paleontologist, probably butchered that, once suggested Anorognathus would behave similar to the modern dinosaur, the Nightjar, using long wings and swift flight to surprise its prey. Over time, the size of those wings has been reduced, and Anorognathus was probably more focused on maneuverability than speed, but I think the Nightjar is still a really cool skin inspiration, so we're going to use Limpopo River for the skin colour and the Pulcrana pattern to get something a little bit similar in coloration with the Nightjar, although you could also do a patternless version that would work really well as well. Next up is the dinosaur that inspired this video in the first place. It's Nodosaurus swapping over to Borealopelta. Now, Borealopelta, a Nodosaurid ankylosaur from Canada, is most known for the phenomenal holotype specimen dug out from what was once the Western Interior Seaway. This thing was remarkably well preserved. You can see all the plates, all the spikes. It's incredible levels of detail. But why is this such a good fit? Well, because whoever designed the Nodosaurus for Jurassic World Evolution had clearly been looking at that Borealopelta specimen. That's not a criticism, it's an incredibly detailed look at a Nodosaurid and a good base for a design, but there's very clear similarities here in the plate spikes between the real specimen and the evolution Nodosaurus, which makes it absolutely perfect for this video. We're going to mix it up for the skin colours based on a fun fact. There was a large amount of charcoal found in the stomach of the Borealopelta, suggesting a recent wildfire in the area. We're going to use the Svalbard skin along with the Papyrana and Lithobate patterns as a fun little nod to this, those charcoal and fiery colours. Next up, one of the more obvious ones in the pack, Tyrannosaurus Rex becomes Tarbosaurus Batar. These two are very closely related, possibly synonymous, with Tarbosaurus representing the Asian contingent of the two, hailing from the floodplains of the Nemet Formation of Mongolia and the Subashi Formation of China. Its environment was prone to both droughts and humidity, fluctuating between fairly disparate seasons across the year. Because of that, you could utilise a mix of colours depending on your exhibit design, but inspired by prehistoric planet, I've decided to go more arid with it. The 1997B skin is perfect for this, but you could also use Salar del Huesco as a skin colour and Killian Mountains, along with the Rana and Pelophylax patterns to really sell that arid coloration. For our aquatic for this video, we're going from Shonisaurus to Himalayasaurus. Now, Jurassic World's slightly silly sizing, and I mean the film here, has helped us out a little bit with this one. Shonisaurus in this game is about 80% the size of the Mosasaurus. And okay, the Mosasaurus is gigantic, because it's something like 200 feet long at times in Jurassic World, but in reality the largest Mosasaurus, Hoffmanni, was more in the 60-foot range. Conversely, Shonisaurus sicaniensis grew up to nearly 70 feet in length. Now, it's worth noting that sicaniensis could instead be a species of Shastasaurus, but let's ignore that because A, it's up for debate still, and B, it's less fun. We're also going to ignore that Shonisaurus popularis is basically the perfect size because Now, this wasn't an easy one to find equivalents for because Shastasaurus felt like a boring pick, but Shonisaurus, with its chonky body and lack of dorsal fin, is pretty unique amongst ichthyosaurs. There's a pretty cool one though called Himalayasaurus. It's potentially a nomen dubium, a dubious name, due to lack of distinguishing factors, but some have suggested its unique cutting teeth may warrant it as its own genera. Either way, it's called Himalayasaurus, and I like that, and it's a good size, and it's a combination of Svalbard and Kolkarana gives it this great mountainy sort of feel in the coloration. Penultimately, we're going to go from Morris intrepidus to Avia tyrannis. Now, Morris is a pretty obvious choice for reclassification because it's, well, it's bloody tiny. The one in Dominion is clearly a juvenile, but that's the one we've got in evolution too, even when it's birthed, you know, assumedly at full age. So let's instead reclassify it into something a little bit more size appropriate. In this case, Avia tyrannis. It's a little up for debate as to whether it is a tyrannosauroid like we'd want, but in current standing it definitely has the right morphology to represent something similar to our Morris, and the holotype was estimated at a teeny tiny 3.3 feet in length, making it a much better fit for the in-game size of Morris intrepidus, which in reality, when fully grown, was more like the size of a human, a little bit smaller but not much. Found in late Jurassic Portugal, Avia tyrannis lived in, as far as I can figure out, a brackish sort of lagoon, similar to a modern mangrove swamp. We're going to use the Amazon rainforest and Salar del Huesco skin colours along with the Papyrana and Lithobates patterns to give our version a suitably swampy aesthetic. And finally, we have Iguanodon to Lurdosaurus. Now, Lurdosaurus is a pretty good replacement genera for Iguanodon, specifically the Dominion variant, which I think people are a lot less attached to when, say, compared to the Giga. Lurdosaurus is a little smaller than Iguanodon, matter of a few feet at the highest estimates, which actually fits the Dominion morph even better, but Lurdosaurus is also known for its really low ground clearance. Its stomach would have sat pretty close to the floor, and the Dominion Iguanodon is much lower to the ground than the original Frontier version. Tick tick, really. Lurdosaurus is from early Cretaceous Niger and was speculated to be a hippo-style creature by Thomas R. Holtz Jr. in 2007. Stocky, heavy, slow-moving, but capable of bursts of speed as necessary. Some have also said it would be reminiscent of a ground sloth, which isn't that relevant to this, but it's very cool. We're going to lean into the hippo aesthetic with the Killian Mountain skin colour, along with both lithobates and blank patterning. And that's it. Give your dinosaurs some new little code names, and okay, yes, you're never going to get rid of the original genera name entirely. I still think this is a pretty cool way to expand your exhibits, inverted commas. Maybe now you can make that exhibit from a certain region or a certain time period that was maybe a little bit more restricted in the past. This is really just a bit of fun, I'm not going to pretend otherwise, but I think especially for people who don't use mods, this kind of creative accounting is a really cool way to expand your parks in a different way. And of course, there's a bunch of other possibilities out there that you could definitely utilize. You're not just limited to these 8 that I've listed in today's video. Lots of dinosaurs were relatively similar. And you know, I've tried to keep it here to different genera, but you could also just mix it up on a species by species basis as well, and that way you'd have a lot of overlap. Either way, this was a fun video for me. I really enjoyed doing my research and trying to come up with the variants, and I hope you've enjoyed it as well. If you have, please do throw me a like down below in the comment section. That would make you super cool. Finger guns. You know, only cool people do finger guns. And I hope you're all having a lovely weekend as well. Thank you so much for joining me. I'll see you lovely folks very soon. Cheers much of as always. Bye-bye.